not only is this nation here, but many of us individually are here. Amen. So this is not just a corporate word, it's also an individual word. Amen? Amen. I'm trying to give a working title to this message. I know you know how you hear something, but you don't, the words don't sound right. I know what I want to say, but the words don't sound right. I'm trying to give it a title. You know how, like when God sets us free, when God's loosing us, God loose, but we don't really like the way he looses us. So I'll have to work on the title for this to I got intentionally entangled. Intentionally entangled. Or I could just name it intentionally. Or he's intentional. Could name it that. We'll see which title fits better. Because I want to show you, well, let's go to Exodus chapter 14. Now, just open up to receive the word of the Lord. I really believe there's not a lot of people prophesying, because in this hour it takes courage to say, to tell the truth. It takes courage to put something out on the airwaves when you know they are persecuting people for telling the truth now. So this is the reason why many people's mantle is getting revoked. That's prophetic too. Many people's mantle is getting revoked based upon disqualification for ear tickling. And so as many people's mantle gets revoked, they're going to become an increased hunger for the word of the Lord. When the Bible says in the time of Samuel, the word of the Lord was scarce. And so that's why you see people traveling to this little church, you know, from all over the place just for the word. We're not casting out devils here. We're not healing right now. We're not doing anything that you think is dynamic. It's just the word. Because that's what's scarce. He sent his word. It'll heal you. And so this is what we have to exalt, the word of God. The church is guilty for exalting the dynamics, and that's why people are deceived, because they don't know the word that keeps you grounded and rooted. Now, all right, so look at verse 1 of chapter 14 of Exodus. Now this is where we are. I'm gonna keep reiterating that this is where we are. Amen. Moses and them have just gotten the word, I believe, from Pharaoh, and that's tell them they can go. And of course, this thing that's going on in America is based upon this racial edge. The more I keep seeing this, the more I feel that God is behind it in some way. I don't believe God is having folks kill folks. That's Satan's work. But I believe God is stirring it. I believe God is stirring it because he's going to use it to force an agenda that would not be forced otherwise, that would not come to fruition. When God's people ask for freedom, they don't really remember when Moses, they was in Egypt crying for freedom. But when Moses showed up, they did not agree with Moses. They did not even like Moses. They could not get with the fact that this is what God chooses. His deliverance does not look like the deliverance that they was waiting on. The same way when the disciples were looking for the Christ, they asked him, when are you going to come into your kingdom and take over, kill the Romans and set us free? And that wasn't the deliverance that he was bringing. He was bringing a deliverance of the heart. That the true prison, the true slavery was the body enslaving the spirit to sin. Oh. So they was looking at the Romans enslaving them, but it was the flesh enslaving them to sin. So he came to deliver them from themselves. His deliverance doesn't look like what we think, because it's very important for him to do it, say, his way.
His way.
His way. Now, so this is where we are in Exodus 14. God is has whooped Egypt and is making them let his people go. Y'all there?
Amen.
Now remember, this nation is paralleling it, and they are hiding the judgments of God. They're not letting you know this nation is under judgment.
Amen.
And so that's why it doesn't, because of fear that you'll look at the biblical story,
yes,
and you'll begin to understand the outcome based upon the scripture.
Amen.
The prophetic word. That's why the Bible says prophecy is a more sure word. It's sure than DNA. I go with prophecy. I go with the word of God. It's more sure.
Amen.
And so this is the reason why they are very afraid of this book, because they realize that this book, it reveals the plans of the enemy 2,000 years ahead of time. Are y'all there? And those that follow this book won't be deceived. The spirit of the world, or the Antichrist spirit, will not saturate those, because we have a spiritual shield that causes us to resist. Are y'all there?
Amen.
The spirit of the world that tries to saturate our heart. Are you there?
Amen.
Now let's look at verse 1. I want to show you something. And the Lord spake unto Moses. Now remember, I said intentionally entangled.
Okay.
And the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, speak unto the children of Israel that they turn and encamp before Pihahiroth, between Migdal and the sea, over against Baal Shephon, before ye shall encamp by the sea. For Pharaoh will say of the children of Israel, they are entangled in the land, the wilderness has shut them in. Now, the Bible is saying that Moses is on a God-led journey.
Amen.
He didn't go the wrong way. The warfare is coming, yet he went the right way.
Amen.
The enemy's coming, yet he went the right way.
Yes.
His life is threatened, but he went the right way. He's under attack, but he went the right way.
Amen.
God led him, intentionally entangled him. Are you hearing what I'm saying? Because it's important how God brings you out. God is a spectacular God. The way he likes to do things is flashy, because he loves the glory. So he could have just, how many of y'all know, he could have pricked Pharaoh's heart right in his castle, never told nobody else. Pharaoh woke up one day and said, go on and go. The rest of the Egyptians would have never knew why he let them go. They just went on. They wouldn't have knew why changed Pharaoh's heart. God could have did it if he wanted to.
Amen.
The Bible says that God purposely said, I'm going to harden.
Yes.
We are in a, this is what's going, y'all got to catch prophetic. Now I'm going to be on two levels. I feel I'm two level preaching there. This is where we are. It's Pharaoh is listen, don't look at Pharaoh in America as a man. It's not a man. Pharaoh is the system. Oh, Lord, help me. Pharaoh is the government system set up to keep a people enslaved. Not only us, but mainly us, but other people are enslaved too. It's a system that Don't matter what man come, the system does it automatically. Don't matter. That's the reason why every man you get doesn't change the system. The system is perpetual slavery. Where we may not get money off of you physically picking cotton and picking corn and stuff, but we found ways to extract money off of you.
Amen.
We find ways to extract money from you. Even if you don't want to work for us, we have ways, the system will put you in a position where you will work for us. So we're not talking about a man. Get off the man. Get off the candidate. Get off Donald. Get off Donald Trump. Get off this girl here. Get off Barack. They are just the figurehead put over a system. They're not even over the system. They was elected by the system to further the wishes of a system. So that's why nothing changes. Everything, Democrat, Republican, left wing, right wing, is just smokescreen for you to believe there's a choice in the system. But there is no choice. If you choose left, the left wing is a part of the same system. If you choose right, the right wing, the whole point is we don't care which wing you choose, just don't leave the system. Because the system has parameters that as long as you stay within this system, we could prophesy your outcome. We know exactly how you'll end up. Those that get outside the system are those that receive how can I put it? Let's see. Let's go deeper. I feel it deep. See, the goal is to get outside the system. Now, nothing can break the system because the system is what Morpheus told Neo, it's the world pulled over your eyes. The system's everywhere. You have to be awakened. Now, Jesus told Nicodemus, because Nicodemus came talking about the system. And Jesus told Nicodemus, listen, man, the system, you can't get out of the world y'all in except you be born.
Amen.
You got to be born again to even see.
Amen.
To see you are in a system.
Amen.
You don't know you in a matrix. You got to be born again.
Yes.
So the goal is for you never to see it. Say never see it.
Never see it.
So the system is what they're hiding with the illusion of freedom. Did y'all?
Amen.
You have an illusion. Let me show you. The system tells you that freedom is getting your own house.
Right.
It's getting your own car. That's what the system's built to do. The system sells you the system's dream, which is the American dream.
Right. Yeah.
We all come into this. We all grow up with that idea.
Right.
So you believe that. You believe that you are free to get a house and to get a car. You believe
right.
that car and house is yours.
Right.
The system is planned for you to think that way.
Amen.
Now, the system knows on the back end that the house and the car is another level of control. Because in order to get the house, I'm going to lock you in to my system for 30 years. So you can't move for 30 years. I'm going to control part of your income for 30 years. But you thought you was free. No, the system is built to make you think you're free. Are you there? Well, I tell you what, we just need to get educated. So you go to school to get educated with the system's education and get a paper. The system said makes you smart, but that paper do not work outside of the system. You to get the system job, you got to have that system paper. Now, if that wasn't true, there are people that are ignorant, never went to school, but millionaires. Are you understanding what I'm saying? So the goal is to get outside. Y'all got that? Now, nothing breaks the hold or gives you awareness of the system. This is what they're trying to stop. This is what they're fighting. Every movie, TV, music is fighting against the awakening spirit. How can I put this? It's fighting against what wakes man. What wakes man is the light. The light is true, but the Bible says, in the beginning was the Word. The Word was God. The Word was with God. In him was light, and the light was the life of men. In him was life, and the light was the light of men. The light shine in the darkness, but the darkness cannot understand. The darkness will not overcome it. So what they're trying to do is they know that this light reveals the system. So they're turning you against the light. Did y'all hear what I said? See, when they see a marriage, that marriage, because it's antithesis, it's anti-system. That marriage illuminates the system around it. That's why people get upset when they see it, because it's illuminating, this light is illuminating. Are you understanding what I'm saying? The Bible says men loves darkness because darkness, because their evil deeds are not seen. Y'all get what I'm saying? So it's the light that Satan is making people hate, because the light illuminates. Are you understanding what I'm saying? Now, can we keep going? So listen, let's just cut one step further before I go. What is the system? Let's see if we know what it is. What was the system in the Matrix? What is the system? Ultimately, what is this system? Slavery. The system is slavery. The system, come on, say the system is slavery. Now, you thought you were free, right? You went to school, right? You thought you were free until you had to pay the school loan. The school loan feels like slavery. Everything you do in a system feels like slavery. You got what I'm saying? You working a good job till FICA come. And you find that a third of your money is going to somewhere. You don't even know where that money went. It's built into the system. Are y'all there? Because the whole goal of the system is to keep you working. It's never, the Bible says when we serve Christ, we labor to enter into his rest. Yes. The system, which is the system of Satan, is designed to never rest. Yes. You work till you die. Amen. And because when a person is working, what don't you do? You don't enjoy. Yes. You can't enjoy nothing. Are y'all hearing what I'm saying? Amen. Every now and then you need to unplug and take $100 of that paycheck and go enjoy. Why just labor for this stuff and never enjoy? Every now and then you got to do that. Even if it means you cut into another bill, just we make it up later, but just go enjoy. Why? Because the system is designed of slavery for you never to enjoy, because oppression is the tool of control. Keeping you under pressure is what controls you. Don't believe me? Well, you don't really want to go to work. You go to work because of bill pressure. That's a measure of control. They got you on that job 30 years, 25 years. Why? Just based upon the pressure of bills. It's a system of control. Amen. Now you say, what is the control? I'm getting paid. No, the control is you're a slave. Amen. You're not living your true potential. Amen. See, Christ frees you from the system. Yes. So that you can fulfill true purpose. Then the system, you take the resources of the system to fulfill purpose. Without Christ, the system is your purpose. It's to work in the system. Did y'all not hear what I said? See, without Christ, you have no purpose. Going to work is your purpose. Did y'all hear what I said? That's your purpose. Y'all work with him all the time. Guys, they get up, go to work. They, on the weekend, they got to go get drunk or high because they don't know how to get a release from the system. And then they go blow all their money and go do it all over again. You wonder why they doing that. Because their reward is more system. But you can come to the house of God, lift your hands and get out, and for however long you hear, and for however long you pray at home, you get outside of this. Come on, y'all not hearing what I'm trying to teach y'all. And many people cannot, see, without Christ, you can't do that. So you got to commit suicide. You got to drink. You got to get high. Look at the TV shows. Look at how nothing is done without drinking. Nothing. Soon they come out like, need to drink. Drinking, they just drink. That's all they do. Why? Because they're trying to find physical, temporary escapes from the system. That's what it's about. Are you hearing what I'm saying? And the system is slavery. This is the reason why people get 60 years old, 70 years old, and look back with a life of regrets. Because they played the game the way they were told. They told you if you go to work, if you get a job, if you did everything you were supposed to do. This is one of the biggest reasons for divorce. Because it's not that the marriage was bad. The system was bad. The system told y'all both got to work, y'all both got to do. And so y'all running out doing what the system say. And you not living, you not enjoying the marriage. Marriage ain't just hooking up to be together, it's to enjoy. I'm enjoying my life with you. But if you always working, and I'm always working, and we always paying bills and wiping butts, there's no time for the marriage. So this system that forces us to go out here and make money will break the marriage. Are y'all there? And the same way you feel under the hand of an oppressor, that's how you are feeling your marriage when there's no release from the labor. Y'all ain't ready to talk to me. There has to be a release from that labor. But if we together all the time and there's never a release from the labor, I start feeling the same oppression of a person driving me all the time. Then I want to get out of this. This is all based on me believing what the system told me we got to do in order to make it. Are y'all hearing what I'm saying? So, let's tie this in. I could stop, actually. I said enough, actually. I could stop right there. No, y'all got to learn how to get the word quick. Had me laboring 2 hours to tell you. You got to just get it. That was a good, that's really, a lot of men and God be like, shoot, I'm done. That's just enough. That's, I done said more than what they would have said in an hour. I want you to understand there's many facets of slavery, many ways to be a slave. Are y'all there? We only thinking about the slave. When we say slave, first thing you see is cotton. You know, whipped in the back and cotton. That's what your first thing you think of. But there's many levels of slavery. There's levels of control. And the reason why we think we free is because we only know one level of slavery. Because they only make movies about the one level of slavery. But if they start talking about the other levels, you would see I'm still a slave. I'm still enslaved. Are y'all there? Because the true power of slavery is what? Control. The true power of slavery is make you do what I want you to do. So if you don't think you a slave, every city has you under control. Somewhere in a population, you somewhere in a west end, a south end of the city under control. It's another, remember, now I don't know if y'all can remember this, but remember the Matrix when Neo finally realized that all of that was, even, you know, the Oracle was just part of the Matrix, you know, and he realized that it was had happened, the Matrix had actually happened before, and he came back and told Morpheus, this is just another level of control. And Morpheus couldn't believe it because he's like, no, man, the Oracle says, no, this is another level. Of, this is the level. See, if you don't understand that level of slavery, then you think you're free, but you're just in another level. I woke up from the Matrix, but I'm still a slave. Because I'm still under control. The Matrix is still controlling me, even though I'm woke. Can we talk? Come on, this is deep teaching, y'all. It's deep teaching. Look, so this is where we'll pick up Exodus at, because you have to understand that it's very important for God to allow us to get intentionally entangled, because if you're not entangled in the Matrix, you'll never see it.
Wow.
So he lets us get entangled with it, or we'll never see it. If you'll never see it, you can never do nothing for God, because the Matrix is so, well, I don't even want to say it like that. This system is so crafty that if you don't see it, whatever you build will eventually get overtaken by it. So he has to show it to you. But you won't see it unless you experience it. Why? Because I can't tell you what it is. But you have to know it. If I say what's racism, you don't know. But you know what it feel like. You've had to experience it to know it. You go to another country, talk about racism, a lot of time they will not understand what you're saying because they don't experience it. But you go and see another black person that come from that same country, and you ain't even got to say, y'all can look at each other and know, I know what that means. Experience is your greatest teacher. So God intentionally allowed you to get entangled. He intentionally done this to his Hebrew people so that they will understand bondage. They were in Egypt. It's called the house of bondage. You will never stop doing stuff except he let the repercussions of bondage touch your life. And the longer you in bondage is because your will is that strong. You will not stop. If God sets you free today, you be back doing it. So he leaves the bondage. This is the reason why I understood the Apostle Paul. The Apostle Paul's revelation was so great that I knew Paul battled pride. You could tell the way Paul wrote, he battled pride. Talking that talk he talking, I mean, as deep stuff as he saw, I could tell he battled pride. He knew that God left that thorn in his side for a reason, because if he didn't leave that thorn in his side, Paul would have kept going into pride. Pride would have robbed Paul of his true mission in life. So God left it. Paul said, I prayed about it. So some of y'all who don't know why you still go through what you go through, I prayed about it. I asked God to take it away. He said, 3 times I prayed, and God wouldn't do nothing about it. Because this pride, this thorn in my side, was a tool. It was a tool. He intentionally entangled me. He left something in my life that makes me pray, that makes me weep, that makes me humble. He left it. Could have took it out. He's God. But he did it intentionally. And you can either spend the rest of your life crying over the thorn in the side, or get to understand of why it's there. Instead of looking at the thorn as, look at the thorn as a badge of honor. I'm so great, he had to give me this. He had to give me this. This is why I try to tell y'all, when I say pray for me, y'all think I'll be playing. I'm not saying it. The revelation is so great that the warfare is greater than the revelation. Well, I don't know if it is, but the warfare is great. So when Jeremiah said, when I said I would not speak his word, it was like fire shut up in my bones. A lot of men of God don't want to talk. We know what this revelation entails. Satan hates when you say stuff. He hates when you have revelation and knowledge. So this revelation, that's why you pray for men of God. Now, let me get into this. Say intentionally entangled. Nathan says, speak unto the children of Israel that they turn and encamp. Okay, now verse 3. And Pharaoh will say of the children of Israel, they are entangled in the land, and the wilderness has shut them in. And I will harden Pharaoh's heart. Even though they got out,
right.
Even though they got free, they got beyond Pharaoh. They still entangled. It's intentional. Some stuff you go through is just intentional. This thing that's happening in this country, if I switch to this other level, this thing that's happening in this country, it's intentional. I know it don't look like it's sad because people are losing their life. But God has to allow certain things to happen to push this country to have the conversation it won't have. The conversation they gonna have that they don't want to have is reparations. They gotta have it. They don't want to have it. They keep on, every time we come up with it, they deny it. They kill our leaders when they talk about it. Johnny Cochran was gonna do that and they killed him. Every time. Why? Because that's what they don't want to do. Why? Because they understand it's the same spirit that happened to Egypt. They will be spoiled. Literally, America will be no more. See, they don't want you to go. That's a lie. Only people say that are poor white folk. They don't want you to go. These white folk with money know better. You are the greatest consumer. They don't want you to go nowhere. Their economy works off you. If you leave, the police are closed down. If you leave, the judges are closed down. If you leave, many stores are closed down. None of the foreigners will make money if you leave. They don't want you here. That's all. Because if they really wanted you to go, they would already have paid you to go. They don't want you to go nowhere. You are creating the economy. Is this too much for y'all? Now, so this is important that you realize that Pharaoh, this system of Pharaoh, this matrix system, it says what it does not mean. Is this too many? Are y'all there? It says, you have to get this point so I can be done. It says what it does not mean. This system says, you know, all on the news, talking points. See this is just a fatherless in the black community. But then they push welfare. They say that let's crack down on drugs. But then they're trying to declassify heroin for their children. They're trying to decriminalize heroin. See, the system says what it don't mean. Are you hearing what I'm saying? Pharaoh said they can go, but he didn't mean it. He just said it. God put him under so much pressure that he had to say it, but he didn't mean it.
Amen.
Are y'all there? The same way when they said you were free, they didn't mean it. They just said it. Because if they meant it, once they emancipated us back in what, 1860-something? When they emancipated us, why'd it take another 100 years, 150 years, before we still getting killed? They didn't mean it, they just said it. We need to know that so that we stop falling for this freedom illusion. If you fall for that, your child will be a slave to a system. You may be old enough, but your child will be a slave. Let me go one step further. I told y'all, and I know some of y'all still don't get it. You won't believe it until it happened. They are going to put you out of this country. There is going to be an exodus here. They're going to make you leave her. Either they're going to make you leave or we're going to leave on our own, but you're going to leave her. I know y'all don't want to get it because y'all have Stockholm syndrome. No, black people have Stockholm syndrome. That's why the world looks at us and laugh. Africans are laughing. Everybody laughs at us because they say, why would y'all even, we want to stay here. That's what they use our civil rights leaders to do, to make us want to be with them. when we should have known. Now, Muhammad Ali said before he died, y'all know way back in the 60s, they was interviewing Ali. Ali told him, we will never, ever integrate. We will never have equality. White men and black men, they will never be together. This country will be destroyed before they do that. He was right. He was right. Now, the point that I'm trying to make to y'all is, when I told y'all, this is the swelling point. What, look at, remember the Exodus. All that's going on, just keep your mind on what happened in Exodus. God is plaguing a nation. The Egyptians are finally realizing this ain't just the works of nature. There is actually a God fighting for this people. Everything we do to them to afflict them, they keep on rising. See, we're getting to a critical mass point. This is critical now. Y'all know what I'm saying? And so what's going on with this nation is coming to grips. Say coming to grips. I got to close. It means it's coming to terms that these people that they've tried everything in their power to sweep away, to put under the rug, to get rid of, is becoming the thorn in the side. They can't get rid of you. Are y'all there? And so what they gonna do is, see, I kept thinking, well, black people just will go off and, you know, ride. And then, and I said, it probably won't even happen like that. I said, it's gonna be the same way God had to deal with Pharaoh. That's what's happening. How did God force Pharaoh? How did he break the Egyptians? He broke the system. He messed with their economics. He messed with their religious system. He even took their children, their inheritance, all of that, took it away. That's how he breaks the system. And now why you see white men, white officers killing us now, it's because they're feeling their system being messed with. They're feeling what wasn't shaking in their life. See, why they've never felt this. They never felt a system where when they tell us to shut up, we shut up. But now we won't shut up. You know that I'm white and that's how it is system. They used to use that. And they tell us this is how the police said this happened, that's it. And we had to accept it, but now no, we won't receive it. They don't like that. Don't like that. So now the system is, see, the power of the matrix was the invisibility, was the anonymity. I don't know it's there. But if you remember when Neo and them sort of waking up others, the more people that saw the system, it caused a overload. It caused the system to begin to break down because more people was getting free from the system, and the system needs the people to work. Because if you remember, Morpheus showed Neo what the matrix turns you into, a battery. You are the energy for the system. See, you are, y'all don't want to hear what I'm saying. You are the energy for the system. If you stop, the system will destroy, the system will implode. So the more people wake up and get outside the system, the more they get desperate to cut the head off, because they understand that if enough people wake up, it's going to destroy the system. Are you understanding what I'm saying? So what happens? They get desperate. Why? Oh, too many people waking up. Oh, man. We had the rappers talking about killing. Now the rappers are coming together. The Crips and the Bloods are coming together now. What's going on? Wait a minute. That's not how the system's supposed to work. We got we spent 60 years turning the black woman against the black man. Now the black women are out there talking about Black Lives Matter with the black man. That ain't the way the system's supposed to work. See, this is what's happening. The system is imploding. And so what happens? Desperation. That's why they shooting now. That's why they killing. Because this is the same way Pharaoh felt after he realized my system is gone. One, he just got to the point where now violence is always the end result. When the system fails, violence has to be the end result. But remember Pharaoh told them back in the first chapter, Exodus, that let's deal wisely Well, see, once you wake up, he can no longer deal wisely. So now he gonna come right out. See, we're waking up, so you can't trick me no more. I ain't falling for this. This welfare game you played on us. No, this ain't no. And now we waking up, so he can't no longer deceive us. So he's mad. He can no longer kill you by deception. So the last ditch effort is just straight out. And that's why they executing our people now. It's based upon the implosion of a system, the system of control, based upon becoming awake. Are y'all there? Now, let me get done. Is this too much? He says now, and I will harden, verse 4, and I will harden Pharaoh's heart that he shall follow after them. I told you, God's going to allow them to follow us. They don't want you to go. And I will be honored because this is what God wanted. What did God want? I want honor and glory from Pharaoh. Pharaoh going to say I'm God. So was this about the Egyptians and Israel, or was it about God and Pharaoh? God is going to get his glory. Are y'all there? In the process of him getting glory, he's disciplining his people to serve him properly. And once the realization hits us as a people, as a nation, while we're in this condition, that we did not follow the Most High properly, and he establishes that, we won't have to worry about going off no more, because we'll realize what this 400 and some years did to us. And we'll realize the Most High, he's serious. If you don't follow him, he will let you go into slavery. The realizations is happening. Even when I said something at the Sunday, but see, our problem is that we don't understand we are raggedy. Waking up is a raggedy process. And so you have some people hearing God a little bit, and they run out in a raggedy way, and they turn you off because they're talking about everybody going to hell, and y'all ain't saved, and only black people say, see, that's the raggediness of it, but that's all right, because somebody's still waking up off of that. It takes a while for us to get it together. The point is, don't let people that hate your people point out the raggediness of your people. We'll judge them, but you can't. We'll talk about them amongst ourselves. Because they always got those that run to the white media against their people. They always go get a Negro to fight a Negro, and we all look silly because Negro's up there fighting another one. I'm like, why y'all ain't fighting? I wouldn't even go against you, dude. I don't even care what you say. I ain't going against you. For them, they sit back laughing. What do you think about it? Of course, he got a $1 million contract. You think he gonna say it's racism? No, it ain't no racism. No, I think the black guys shouldn't be out there doing wrong. That's what Charles Barkley said. Why do y'all even listen to this guy? These are gatekeepers, man. These are the ones that, these are the boule people, the ones that the kings go to in the black community to keep us under control. All right, let me get done. Look. And it says, and upon all this host, and Egyptians may know that I'm the Lord. And they did so. Verse 5, and it was told the king of Egypt that the people fled, and the heart of Pharaoh and of his servants was turned against the people. And they said, why have we done this? Now, then listen and say, why have we done this? Come on, I got to close. We'll say, why have we done this? This is what's happening in America. Right? Listen to me. Come on, can y'all talk or not talk? Right now, white people are saying, why do we give them any freedom at all? This is what they interpret in Donald Trump's slogan as make America great again. Y'all got to know what that means. Because if you know history, it was never a time. The great time was the time we had no rights. So they're saying now, if they was going to treat, you know how people, you know how somebody mistreats you and then do something for you and expect you to be grateful? Well, if they was going to do this, we should have never gave them. We should have never let them ride the bus. We should have never integrated. We should see they say, this is what they're saying now. Because what is being done was not of their control. Wow. God made them do what they did not want to do. Are y'all sick? Are y'all even catching what I'm saying? They don't want to do this. They didn't want to, they never want to integrate. They had to go get armed guards to let you into school. They didn't want you integrating. See, they make like now, oh, we just loved y'all so much. No. They fought a war where if you lived on the other side of Kentucky from Tennessee, you and your brother fought, killed each other over us. Yes. So you got to see how powerful that is. Brother killed brother to keep you in slavery. They didn't want to let you go. But when they tell the history, they make like, oh, we just got so tired of y'all being in slavery, so we just said, go ahead and go free. No, they didn't want to let you go. We knew we were wrong, so we wanted y'all to go to school with us. Forget all the, go look at the footage of the girl that had to go to school, armed guards walk. They didn't want you to be free. We just let y'all vote. Look at how many people got lynched. They got signs on black people lynched. This nigga tried to vote. Lynched him. Nothing that you've ever gotten, they wanted to give. Same way, nothing that Pharaoh did for the children of Israel, he wanted to do. He only did it because of the plagues. So now the ultimate of letting you go, they woke up and said, why did we do this? We should have never let them go. So when the realization that we're losing, it's what's happening. It's going to make them say, we're going to put them back where they were. They're in the South, there's a movement for you to take you back into slavery. It's a movement going on. Y'all better wake up, man. That's why you're going to have to be crying out to the Most High. You got to realize America ain't your home. I'm trying to help y'all. If Jesus don't come and we still here, you better start praying that, Lord, help me. Now, see, if black people decided tomorrow that, okay, y'all want us here, we ready to roll. And we ready to posse up, guess what they would do? They would kill every passport in the world. They would stop you because they don't want you to go. The same way, why? Pharaoh and them's economy was based on the children of Israel. Do you not see that's who you are? I can't even get, I'm tired of telling black folk this. You are living out the word of God and don't even know it. And they looking at y'all knowing it. They looking, no, these are the people, these are these people. And we know that if we let them go, it means the destruction of America. I truly believe the only reason God's grace is on this nation is because we're still in it. Yes. That's what I believe. And listen, nothing you build here is going to last because the land is cursed based upon the fact it was stolen from the Indians. So while we're trying to build something here, it won't work. And so as much as they yell at go back to Africa, notice they never have a solution. Notice they never, you know, if I was a white man, I'd say, white man, you got money. Let's just go ahead and buy some land and give it to these people. Then they can go. But they ain't talking about, they know you can't go nowhere. That's just a white slogan. Because what they're really telling you is, if you don't like how we treat you, if you don't agree with getting killed and us being racist towards you, that's what they're telling you. If you don't agree, then go. Like, put up with how we treating you or go. And we sit there and fall for that arguing, that talking point. I'm not arguing with that. That's why I say, pay me, I'll go. Just pay me. I think my ancestors' portion, I settle for a cool $10 million. Cool, $10 million. That should be enough. You know, if you're talking about trillions, I mean, at least it's $10 million for me. I'll settle for that. I'll take that and roll. You know how well you can live? You go down to Mexico and get a 3-bedroom house for $300 a month. Utilities $20 a month. Mexico. Go to Cuba, buy a whole 100 acres. $5,000. See, other nations of the world, but see, America don't want you to know that. They don't want you to know that there's options because, listen, y'all, now listen, we ain't going to be preaching this stuff and we're not going to have to think it. Y'all don't believe me. I can't wait till one day the media y'all trust in, because you know only, y'all don't believe it till white people tell you. White people got said on Fox or CNN, that's when y'all believe it. Black man telling you, I don't know. White man tell you, oh yeah, I know now, white man said it. But see, I'm trying to tell y'all, one day you're going to wake up and see reparations. Amen. And you're going to realize Exodus, because they're going to say, we give you this, we want y'all gone. Oh, they gonna be amen. A lot of people gonna be just like that nigga on Django. Oh, Calvin! Oh, you gonna be just like that. I won't leave Master. It's gonna be a lot of people like that. I guarantee you, it'll be a lot. Oh, can I stay here? Poor, I won't go. I'm American. That's what I'm telling you. I guarantee you, people will be like doing that. Then there'll be some soldiers like, man, I'm ready to roll. But see, we should already have an established mindset. That's why we should be getting into agriculture, black farming. That's why we should be thinking that way. Because if we ever did leave us and have to build a nation, the people that's going to be rich are the ones that know how to get in that soil and bring something out of it. We got to eat. We got to survive. Y'all want this. Y'all want this. So see, I'm ahead of the game. That's why I bought the 45 acres. That was the reason. Because I'm saying we got to learn how to agriculture. We got to learn how to live off of land. I ain't ready for that. They ready to give money subsidies to black farmers now. Black farmers, black men who will go back farming. Because there's no farmers. That's a way to get the land back. I'm just trying to help y'all. This is what's the exodus is going to happen. One day it's going to happen. It may not be for me, but maybe for my children. But it's going to happen. And I've been telling y'all this for a long, long time. And now we're getting to that point. That's why the reason for the racial tension is forcing them to push us out. See, we too comfortable in Egypt. Y'all know it. We are comfortable. We trying our best to assimilate into a culture that's killing you and telling you your life ain't worth nothing. Killing you in front on camera and your life ain't worth, and we don't care. Oh, well, I'm just, it ain't gonna happen to me. I'm all right. I love this nation. Okay. Right. Told my sons, you better not sign up for no army. Don't sign up for none of that stuff. Make them come draft you. Sign up to go in there and fight for them and they brainwash y'all. Y'all get out and the veterans are the worst treated in the nation. Why all the veterans go crazy? Because they make them go crazy. Because them is the one they scared of when they come out of the army. Because the veterans can get with other veterans and form an army. That's why they make them all go crazy. And us, the warrior class, we need to get together, send them to another nation so we can take over Samaria. Get up out of here. And I really believe, y'all don't want to deal with that. The Bible is coming to pass. Stand on your feet. Let me be done. I mean, this is a whole nother mess. I really got a whole lot to say about Exodus 14. I just scratched the surface because the revelation came about the system that I didn't even have that. I wasn't going to say nothing about that. So I had to go with what the revelation was. But I'm going to probably teach this again, this Exodus 14. I didn't even get down to the real point I was trying to make. But that's enough said. And so black people are going to have to live. Listen to me. Listen to how I say this. Black people are going to have to live in a state of emergency. Amen. That means able to move quick. Yes. You need to liquid some stuff. Make some stuff liquid. Put money in other metals and stuff that can trade in other don't have all your money in no 401k and money in this fake system. Take your money out and go get money from an economy that's flourishing. Like you can get South African rands. It's a good economy. You can get buy you some Chinese what's that Chinese yen? Buy you some Chinese yen. Get your what's diversified. Don't have all your money in dollars. Buy you some gold and silver because that stuff's universal. You can trade that trades. Are you understanding what I'm saying? Plan to travel. While it's still legal. But I tell you, no matter what I teach you, some of y'all did, that Jesus is going to take care of us. That's the mentality black folk have. He's going to take care of us. But the Bible says, he who has an ear to hear, let him hear. That means God is saying, look, I'm going to speak. Those that's going to make it going to be listening. You don't listen to what I say, you're going to fall off. You're going to get caught up. So I do believe, I told y'all for years that it's going to be an exodus. I still believe it. I'm not going until I see something different. And that's why when this racial stuff happened, I didn't catch me off guard. I knew. I said, God's got to use something to push us out, because we're comfortable in Egypt. We are happy. We trying to get our houses and cars and lands and live for that, you know, that 30, 40 years retirement. That's what we're doing. Not realizing our children may not even have anything. Our children may not have anything. It may come to a point to where we got to get up out of here. So I'm not telling you to go out the mind, go crazy and go scary. I'm just saying, begin to think. Begin to think. Try to get you some time. I told y'all, y'all don't know why. I know people had asked me and my wife didn't even really know. But I told her later, they ask all the time, why y'all doing it in Costa Rica? They don't know why I did that, why I allowed her to do that. I'm not a fool. I'm like, man, we going to get us some roots in another country. Something go down, we getting roots somewhere else. Yes, I'm not a fool. I mean, I love my daughter. I don't know, I miss her all the time, but I'm like, sometimes it's for the greater good. Let her go get established somewhere, and then something happened. Hey, I can send all my children up out of this country. I believe God's going to take care of me, but I believe he gives us wisdom. You got to have some wisdom. Elder Sherrod was calling me today about talking about insurance, and I was there. I said, you know, your greatest insurance is your land.
Amen.
That's insurance. What you leave your child is your land. You don't need much. Get a GoFundMe to bury me. GoFundMe. That's the way to do it. GoFundMe. You ain't got to worry about that. What you gonna worry about is leaving that land to them kids to live on and build on. They inherit a house. What would you happen to you if you'd have walked right into a house? You'd just inherit it. You ain't have to buy it. You walk right into it, and the house was nice enough for you to stay there and live there, and you ain't have to go out there and work 40 hours a week to go pay a mortgage. How far could you have gone? You could have married a wife. She could have stayed home because you own a home with no bills on it, and you ain't got to run out there and give 40. She giving 40 on the job. You giving 40 on the job. And y'all children are being raised by daycare. And her job is only paying for daycare and gas to take them to daycare. That's all that you're doing. That's really what's happening. One job where you stay home, you own your property, and then if something happened to you, you pass that right on down. Now, that's going to bless your kids, because, see, they ain't got to go out there and work. Can't nobody put them out? That's what I was trying to tell you. Can't nobody put them out? Can't nobody take it? It's yours. You built this, yours. So how much have you already done for them by making them miss a $700 a month payment? He can sit there and think about you. Well, I don't feel like working. I'm gonna mourn daddy another 2-3 weeks. Why? Because he done put me in a position where I ain't under pressure. That's why I say we're a church, we can take up a collection to bury you. We'll fund you. Take that money and buy you some land. Yeah. Buy you some land. And listen, you know, I was going to talk to you too. Remember, we was talking a while back about Puerto Rico. Remember, we was talking about, I'm really thinking about buying land down there. I've been thinking about that for a minute. Like, man, you know what? Because you know how Americans, you know, they running down there. They done opened up Cuba. They opened up Cuba. And now, you know how white folk is. They was exporting it already. And I said, why don't we put up some money together, go down there and buy, you know, 50, 60 acres of land in a foreign country. Wow. Then go down there and talk to the government, and they'll help you develop it. They will help you develop it, because you got the money to buy the land. The world is no longer four blocks and you're dead. This is a global thing. Are y'all understanding what I'm saying? Amen. Did y'all get anything out of that message? It's to make you think. Now, truthfully, see the goal, see him, that's the goal. See, that's the goal, to make him think that way. Yeah. To make them think that way. Make them think beyond America, beyond this hood stuff. That's what the goal is to make them think that way. Because it won't be no greater feeling than something happened to you and you know your child. You train them. They know it. They know what to do. They go in operation. I told Steve, something happened to me, your mama, be looking for your brothers and them. They on their way. Amen. They come. Matter of fact, we got to pick up Hannah tonight. She's on her way back. Amen. We invested in them traveling early. Amen. They were traveling when they were real little. We did it on purpose, got their passports. Listen, if you do nothing else, get a passport. Yes. If you do nothing else, get up. If you never use it, get it and put it on your mirror and look at it all the time to know I got it. If you look at it enough, you'll find a place to go. You'll find a place to go. It's important to have it. It's a right. You want to exercise that right. Some of y'all who've never been out of the country, think about going. So even if you just use some sisters, get together. If you ain't married, get some sisters, go on a cruise, go to Cancun, go somewhere together as sisters just to get out of the country. Know what it feel like to travel. Get that feeling of traveling. Because when I go all over the world, Africans be, not us, but Africans be everywhere. You go on an airplane, Africans, you go up in Alaska, be Africans up there. That's why I know it's more Africans than anybody, because anywhere you go in the world, Africans. I don't care where I've been. Man, Africans got their own spot in the airport. It's like the Africans are everywhere. And you be thinking them cats are broke. Them cats ain't poor. Man, they got money to get on earth. They be everywhere. Go to Nigeria. Go to over in Africa. The whole plane's be full. Like, where you went? Where you Africans going at? Everywhere. They be in Sweden, all white countries. One brother I was in Nigeria, he lived in Hong Kong, was telling me how to get a business in Hong Kong. He was a Ghanaian talking about how to get a business in Hong Kong. He said, man, I got his number. He said, you come to Hong Kong, man, I'll set you up in Hong Kong. I mean, these brothers everywhere. There was a brother that was on the top bunk. He was from Sweden. He was a Nigerian, but he was living in Sweden. He said, man, they treat us so good in Sweden. He was like, man, we are treated so well. So we as African-Americans are in the system. The system of control is they make you afraid of going anywhere. Let me show y'all something. When you get a chance, look up, I think it was Black Man in Mexico. It was a video on YouTube, I saw it today, of a young brother. He couldn't have been no more than 23, 24 years old, living in Mexico. Not saying in Mexico. Now, when we say Mexico, what you thinking? Drug cartel. You know, they cutting people's heads off in the drug cartel. Tim, what's that one right over the border, that city? It's a city right over the border that's notorious. You know, when you cross over, you know, not Tijuana, but I can't think of the name, but Juarez. Where all the, and so now, why do they always have those stories of fear? So you scared. But this brother was shooting a video. He was in, like, right outside Tijuana in a city called Sonora. He said, man, it's so beautiful. He went to, I didn't even know there were Afro-Mexicans down there. They look just like us. They call Afro-Mexicans. But our media won't show them because they don't want you to see them. That's the reason why they never really like to show the Caribbean. They don't like to show Jamaica, even though we know it, but they don't want to show it. I didn't even know about Belize until 3-4 years ago. Belize is an English-speaking black country that we could have went down there. No, now they down there. White people done went down there and bought up Belize. And the indigenous people have to work like slaves for the white people who bought up all the land. And they never let us know them Belizean people are English-speaking, look just like us black folk. And they was down there for years. We had a black country, English speaking. No, I ain't talking about like a funny dialect. Like we speak English. Black people look just like us. The Garifuna. They look just like us. Been down there for hundreds of years and they never let us know because we could have flew right down there. We going to Cancun, don't know. Keep going a little bit. You be right down there where your people is. In a tropical, beautiful, Belize is beautiful. Remember I was telling y'all about Belize a while back? Why do they do stuff like that? Make you fearful so you don't leave. We afraid. They made us scared of flying. Scared of the water. We scared of everything. I'm saying that's one of the number one problems with us. We are scared of everything. I know cats right now living in Louisville ain't been across the bridge. Scared to go across the bridge. Scared to ride across. I ain't going across that water. My mama wouldn't go across the water till maybe we moved over. And it took a long time. I'm talking about over 60 years old wouldn't go across the water. Because fear It's part of the system that keeps us where they want us. You know, some of y'all that grew up in the hood or grew up around, like really in the urban area, you know right now black people who was making good money, they probably working at Ford but wouldn't move. They wouldn't move out of the hood. You'd be like, look, you making good money, why won't you move? I ain't gonna pay that high, I don't know. But really, it's fair. Y'all know people like that make good money. I know girls working for be lying to get food stamps. Because of fear. I'm scared if I let it go, I may need it. No, it's fair. It keeps us down. And that's the reason why they do that, because it's controlled. The system is based on fear. And that's why I try to tell people, you know, every now and then, you know, get away. Get on a plane. Don't be afraid to fly nowhere. You could die in the car too, so don't worry about it. Just get on a plane. Go somewhere. Some of you couples, you know, for y'all, special day, don't wait to anniversaries all the time. I know we got a plan and stuff, but don't always wait to anniversaries. Sometimes just, you know, just for no reason. You know, we just going to take a two-day, you know, you can always get away for a couple of days. We're going to take a two-day trip just to get away. It's very important because, see, as you travel as a parent, see, we sold that in our kids. Yeah. See, when they saw me going to Africa, kept going, getting on planes all the time, Cece was like, oh, okay. It wasn't, see, when she, like, her mind was straight out of her. When she saw me go, she's like, oh, Daddy went, I'm gone. When she saw us go, me and my wife, when we first went to Uganda, and she saw that, and she was ready, she had the bug after that, she's ready to go. Amen. And so you have to listen, you know, it was, you know, like I said, I miss her, I love her, I hate, you know, I had to let her go, you know, how your heart's like, it's my baby, I got to, you know, pray that the Lord, you know, cover and nothing happened. You know how the horror story, I've got the same taking stories in my mind too, you know, all that stuff goes through your head. But I'm like, look, don't project your fear into her life. Let her go and experience life. And see, with my sons, because my sons are I'm black men, I need to be close to them. Because they go through a different type of thing, and I don't want them to. But I'm ready to let them go. I'm ready to let them go, but we already decided they going. I don't even want them here either. I want them to go too. I want them to go on, and I don't really want them even in this country for real, or have to be in this country if they don't want to. But I'm just telling you that so think about the whole goal. I feel like the gospel is supposed to broaden your horizon. I don't feel like you're supposed to sit in the same place for 25, 30 years just sitting there. I feel like the gospel's supposed to take you across the world. And so that's why I said, even if you're a single sister or a single brother, get with a couple of brothers, plan a trip. Let's take a cruise as sister. Let's take a cruise as brother. Let's do something. Because, you get away from her, your mind totally changes when you get out of this oppressive place. I mean, it totally changes. And you begin to think differently. When we go places, I mean, the way we treat it, I mean, it's totally different than when you were in America. I mean, and some of us don't even know what it feel like to go in a country where they don't look at your color. They don't see no black person. They just see you. I mean, that was one of, you know, I wouldn't move to Africa, not them. I might move to South Africa, but not to Africa. But one of the things I really enjoyed was, even in Nigeria, they didn't see the color. They just saw you. And I never felt that feeling before. Matter of fact, you feel good. You feel like, because you don't have to feel like you shadowed by white folk. You don't feel like they watching you when you go in the store. You don't feel like they looking at you less than. You are literally on their level of everybody else. It's what you do that matters. But here is what you look like. So everybody's going global but the African American. Everybody's global except us. We still sitting here waiting on the leader to get us out. When the plane's been there for years, you can have passports, you can travel, but we locked up here. Now think about this. These brothers up in Chicago getting murdered every day. Think about the chain on their mind that, dude, I'm going to get on a mega bus. I'm out of there. If I got to go big down south somewhere, I'll beg up on the house or somewhere to live. I go to the mission, but they'll stay right there and get killed. Because the chain is here, slavery. It's a system. And so the greatest thing you can do is help to broaden the horizons of your children. Encourage them to want to see more. You love them. You know how we're very protective as black folk. We don't like to let out because we got that clan mentality where we hold everybody. But, you know, sometimes you got to let them go. Just try them out. Let them go. Let them go see some things. It's very important. And this is the reason why I'm telling y'all that, because you want your children to go further than you.
Amen.
To go further than you. So one of the goals is to plant ministries in foreign countries. You know, then you can go down and do mission work. You might be doing mission work here. This might be your mission. It might be a mission in this country. Look at what's happening up in Flint. It's stuff happening here. So it might be a mission here. We might not have to go far to do mission work, but we're definitely going to be doing some mission work. And that's why I was, you know, Greg talked to Elder Grant about what we were discussing about. Was it, what were we talking about, Cuba? Cuba, yeah. And I was just looking it up and seeing how pretty it is, but it's like an undeveloped country. Right there waiting to be 90 miles off Florida, you could be in another whole foreign country. I mean, some of y'all, you don't even have to have a passport to go to Puerto Rico, just go. I mean, these are things that you gotta think like that. Listen, one thing I'm gonna tell you and I'm done, don't use your whole Christian life just to go to church. No, I'm serious. You could be going to church. Me and my wife fell into that trap. We trying to get out of it now because we love church so much and we raising our kids and we wouldn't go nowhere. We just heard this, you know, just heard, constantly heard, you know. We never went on a cruise. We never did the things that, because I'm always faithful and loyal and wanting to be here and, you know, and she never complained about it. I mean, because as long as our bills pay, we good. That's what we care about more than anything else. But as we begin to travel more and more, we begin to realize, yeah, this is something that we should have been doing 20 years ago. And that's why I tell y'all, those that love us, you have to encourage us that way. You know, don't always look for us. Want us to go somewhere. You know, I'm serious, because a good pastor won't. A good pastor will just be right here in your face. Like, even the most stuff we do is what y'all saw in Atlanta. We'll go down one day, go do what we got to do, and come back. That's it. That's not no enjoyment. That's just ministry. People pulling off of you all day. You got to come back and minister to your people. And, you know, all week it's the same thing. And so we never really get a chance to do anything. And so that's one of the things that we're trying to plan to do, is to do more, you know, as far as traveling. Our children are catching up. They done been to places. They catching up. So this is why I'm encouraging you to do. Amen. 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 All right. I don't think we need to have no altar call or anything. Come on, lift your hands up. Be blessed. Amen.